Well, hello, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us tonight for Art and Stories. I see that there's a couple more people popping in, so I'll wait a couple more seconds to allow for everybody to get tuned into the technology and to get into our room. But I'm really excited about tonight. And let's see. Yeah. So I want to start off by thanking the Storytellers of San Diego and Marilyn McPhee for reaching out to us about this program. In case you haven't heard me talk about this before, but every time I have such a pleasure doing this series. Getting to meet with the storytellers before we do these events and getting to hear their ideas and their thoughts. It's always so exciting to get to hear this, to get to share, to, you know, have this exchange between the visual arts and the art of storytelling. And it's always just such a pleasure to be part of these meetings and then to come here for the events and get to see the fruition of those conversations. And I always look forward to them so much. And there's something so powerful and healing about someone telling you a story. And I remember this feeling from my childhood with my dad telling me stories about our family while we're walking the dogs in the woods. And now I get to hear these incredible stories from very diverse artists from all different walks of lives, ideas, thoughts. And it's just such a pleasure to get to be part of this. And, you know, there is something truly special about voices sharing their experiences and getting to connect old stories and seeing them in new lights. So tonight we are here to hear more stories that were inspired by our artist in residence, Cammie Staros. And for those of you who are interested in knowing more about Cammie, there's several videos of talks that she's done with Lux of a gallery tour all on our YouTube channel. So check out Lux's YouTube channel. Here's the big fly that I was telling you guys about before. welcome to live interactions, everybody. So Cammie is really inspired, amongst many other things, inspired by Greek and Roman vessels and the mythologies that are depicted on them. But Cammie's uses a twist on them and brings them into a contemporary perspective. And tonight, our storytellers, inspired by this idea, will be sharing their own versions of mythologies in their own contemporary jackets. So if you do have questions at the end of the storytelling, we will open it up for questions to our storytellers. So make sure to put them in the Q&A. And now I would like to introduce our first storyteller of the evening, Mindy Donner. And a little bit more about Mindy. The world and its stories intrigue and inform Donner's practice. Donner creates stage plays with puppets and masks to celebrate visual storytelling. She has performed in France, Mexico, India, China, Korea, and most recently at the Sarawak Children's Festival in Malaysia. Donner was guest editor for the summer's 2019 issue of Storytelling Magazine. Mindy, thank you so much for joining us, and I look forward to your story.
Thank you, Gusha. Well, I was so attracted to the work of Cammie Staros, just for its aesthetic, which is so bare and beautiful. And I've been a Greek myth junkie since I've been in the fourth grade. And I grew up to become a storyteller and a puppeteer. And so the world of myth is so easily anthropomorphic, as is puppetry, because puppetry in its essence is the illusion of life. And so to my storytelling tonight, I am bringing some object theater or object puppetry, it's one and the same practice, together. And I'll be telling a Greek hero's story. So, here it is. Perseus and Medusa, a hero's journey. In the time of monsters, mythical beasts, and the oracle, King Acrisius went to the oracle in Argos to foretell his future. Acrisius, you will be slain by your grandson. No, that can't be. It is. The oracle has spoken. Acrisius rushed home. He shut his only daughter, the beautiful Danae, up in a tower room. And then the unthinkable happened. Now most of you know that Zeus has come to seduce young maidens in many forms and many guises. Sometimes he comes as a swan, and you'll hear that later tonight. And other times as a bull. I don't think you're going to hear that story tonight. But he came in a unique form. He came in the guise of a shower of gold. Very unusual. She was alone in her room. She began to feel very peculiar. Danae noticed little changes. And then, in 9 months, she had a baby boy. A beautiful baby boy, hale and hardy, whom she called Perseus, and she loved him. The king was more than troubled. He couldn't slay them and have their blood, his next of kin, on his hands. He got a chest and made a plan to set them upon the sea. He locked them in. And took them to the shore. He set them out. It was a peaceful sea. And then a squall took the waves and tossed them here and there and everywhere. And they would have capsized, save for the attentions of the maternal and kindly whale. Who deposited them on the shore of a nearby island. They lived. They were caught in a net. Oh my, sodden. But they lived. A fisherman called Dictys took them in, and he and his wife cared for the baby and Danae. All was well for a while. Now, the baby, of course, started to grow. And he was a very beloved baby who grew into a toddler and then grew to be a protective youth. Now, there was a king on this island, Polydectes. He was somehow related to the fisherman family. And when Perseus was almost a man, he had a confrontation over the attentions that Polydectes showed to his mother. Now, Danae shunned his attentions, and Perseus objected, and it made him a marked man.
I'll get that boy off the island for good.
And he contrived a big plan to have a faux marriage and a huge feast and invite all. Now, it was a tradition on the island to give extravagant gifts, and people came with the promise of olive groves and orange groves and fig groves and bags of gold. Perseus had nothing. King, I have my word. And I'll bring you whatever you want.
Whatever I want? Bring me the head of the Medusa.
That was a chorus of Greek gasps. Well, everyone knew that if you looked at the Medusa, you would be turned to stone. And so Perseus went to the oracle. Perseus, you want to know where the Medusa is. First, you must go to the nymphs. They'll give you significant gifts. What? Where? Why? How? What? Perseus, the oracle has spoken. And so it had. So Perseus went and sat down on a rock, feeling a bit forlorn and alone, but oh, wait. He sensed a presence. He wasn't really alone at all. Perseus, you're my boss now. Yeah, I'm Hermes. Yeah, messenger to the gods, and I've been sent to help you. Well, yeah, I know where the nymphs are, and come along, we'll do this. And so Perseus followed his winged guide, and they went along in incredible circumstances. Oh my, you know that it was hotter than hot and colder than freezing, but after all, this is a hero's journey. And they got to the land of the nymphs. These nymphs were dryads. Perseus, we've been expecting you. We have your gifts. The Medusa? No. Ooh, we don't know where she is, but you must go to the Gray Eye, the three Gray Sisters. They'll know. They know everything. Ugh, they've been gray since birth. Be well, Perseus. Be brave. Sounds enigmatic, doesn't it? But together with the gifts, they made their way. And oh, the gifts were just amazing. There was the dogskin cap of Hades, the helmet of invisibility. It fit perfectly. And then there was something from Hermes that he'd entrusted to the nymphs, the golden sandals of flight. Sure to be helpful. And last but not least, there was the magic pouch. And this was going to be the container for the head of the Medusa. Oh my, could be a big head. They went along, they flew over glaciers, they hung by their fingernails, over mist-shrouded crags. And then in the distance, they saw the land of the Gray Eye, the Gray Sisters. Did I tell you that they're querulous and not well-liked and frankly, weird? They shared among them one eye and one tooth.
I want my tooth. I'm hungry.
I want my eye. Ladies, when I count to three, exchange. And in the swap, Perseus grabbed the eye and the tooth.
I want my eye. I want my tooth.
I'll give them back. You need to be peaceful, and I want to know where the Gorgon Medusa lives.
Oh, her. Yes, her. Well, she lives far away over there and near where the Atlas stands, and then on a beach, and
the beach looks like the Riviera, and you must kill her quickly before her sisters catch you. They are vengeful. Goodbye, Perseus, be brave. So Perseus and Hermes went all the way to the end of the earth, near where Atlas stands. And when they came to the beach, why, it did look like the Riviera, and they saw all kinds of statues of people frozen and animals and things. And, oh, yeah. Well, it was time to go to bed, and they needed their rest. They had a most surprising and wonderful visitor. Perseus, the gods favor you. I favor you. I'm Athena, goddess of wisdom, and I've come to give you some. Yes, I have. And Hermes, he was a gift from me. So here's everything you need to know about the Medusa. Well, once she was an attractive woman and she dared to compare her beauty to me. Oh, such a mistake. You'll see. Anyway, she's mortal and you must kill her quickly. Don't look at her. You must see her only in the reflection of my shield, which I will give to you. Ah, those two sisters are immortal. Watch out. Go well, favored one. She left and left her shield. Now, I think everyone knows that Medusa's an early riser. And so Hermes and Perseus set out early in the morning to go down to the beach. And she was getting ready for her day. Yes, it's going to be a pretty big day. Oh, my. Oh, I have to restyle my snakes. Perk up. I'll just wait here for my first visitor. So there she was, caught, reclining, while nude, and she hears footsteps. Perseus had come up. I hear my first visitor. You killed us, sister! Give us the head back. You killed our sister. We want the head back, back, back. Oh, what a morning. Well, as they made ready to go, Hermes bade Perseus goodbye, congratulated him. The mission was accomplished. And so Perseus went by as fast as he could, all the way to the island of Seriphus. He went right away to the house of Dictys and his wife. She was not there. They had been threatened. He found her clinging to the statue of Athena, and he brought her into the convent of Athena for safekeeping. And then he went straight away to the palace with his gift.
Back so soon, Perseus? You failed, didn't you?
Why, no, I didn't fail. In fact, I have your gift here, nicely packaged, and oh, Polydectes was already looking in the bag. Whoa! He was frozen into stone, as was the court. The Medusa's head had power still. Now he went back to the convent to get his mother. Now, this is a plot point which I know is arguable. None of the versions say that she stayed at the convent. But I want to give her agency, and I think she wanted to stay at the convent. And so he kissed his mother goodbye and went off home to Argos by himself. Meanwhile, at Argos, King Acrisius had heard of the imminent return of Perseus and had fled. Well, Ever the competitor, Perseus, stopped at a city called Larissa, whose king was holding an Olympic game. He entered the discus throw. It was a hot, steamy day. It went wild into the crowd and hit a spectator. Who is that? That's Acrisius, king of Argos. He's visiting.
He's been struck dead. Dead.
And so the prophecy of the oracle came true. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mindy. That was, I have a whole new way to think about IKEA bags right now. You know, Medusa has so many different approaches to who she is. And I think, you know, we all think about that a lot. And, you know, you gave consumerism in relation to Medusa and Perseus a new perspective, at least in my mind. Thank you so much. That was really lovely and very humorous.
Thank you.
Our next storyteller tonight is Jim Diekman, and I'd like to introduce him. Jim Diekman has been involved with Storytellers of San Diego since the early 1980s. He has told in schools, museums, nature centers, and on the main stage at storytelling festivals. He's a retired elementary educator and librarian. Jim enjoys the wonders of the natural world and tells folktales and original stories about the sea, the sky, the earth, and the creatures that live there.
So thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to be involved with Lux and this particular program of art and stories. In our interview, Cammie stated that it's necessary to look backward in order to be able to look forward. And I believe that her art really reflects that as well. So if you haven't had a chance to see it, please get on the Lux website and go on the virtual tour. Well, in the Greek myths, the gods and the mortals, they display all of the human emotions as their stories unfold. And it reads, it tells like a present-day soap opera. Well, it surely does in this story of Echo and Narcissus. Hera, the queen of gods, wife of Zeus, had heard about all of his transgressions with other young women and was intent to catch him in the act. There was a granite quarry that filled with water, and during the summer, young people would go there and intermingle, swim in the water, venture off into the woods for intimate relationships. And Zeus was known to frequent this area. He was known to partake. He was older than most of the people there, but you know, he was well built, he was handsome, he was virile, so he was welcomed and he enjoyed himself there. And so it was that on this particular day, Hera was on her way, straight into the forest, onto the pool itself. And on the way, she just happened to run into a very beautiful and very friendly young nymph named Echo. Hera, what a pleasant surprise seeing you here. Are you going swimming? It's such a beautiful day. Beautiful, talk about beautiful. Hera just stood there, mouth agape, wondering why this woman was going on and on. So beautiful. Did you see the awards last night? Why, I couldn't believe some of the gowns there. They were just shimmering like gold. Why, what about Charlize Theron? Did you see how she had her hair cut short and dyed? Why, yeah, you could do that hair. I can't, my neck is too skinny. I would look very, very strange that way. Well, what do you? Hera said, Echo, could you just please shut up? Oh, whatever. And Hera rushed on her way. She rushed down to the pool, casting about looking for Zeus, but saw him nowhere, not in the water, not on the rocks. She started searching through the woods, and she could not find him. He'd escaped. On her way back, she happened to encounter Echo again. Echo, you delayed me in my quest to find my husband. And I think that you are part of a plot. And so, from now on, whenever you speak, you can only repeat the last words of the person who spoke. Who spoke? And from then on, Echo realized that she could not express herself. She could only repeat the last words of the person who she hurt. She resigned herself to her fate. She traveled about the forest, enjoying the natural beauty, until one day she saw a youth, a beautiful young man named Narcissus. Now, Narcissus was handsome, but he was also very vain and selfish. He sought the love of no person. He loved only himself. He was infatuated with his own person. And there he was, walking through the forest. He had a digital camera with a selfie stick, which he held up and took pictures of himself. And then he would look at the images. As he was thumbing through the images, he looked up and he goes, "How beautiful I am." Echo, who had been following him, echoed what he said, "I am." Narcissus looks about him. What? Who? "Oh, I love you," he said as he looked at his other picture. And sure enough, Echo felt that he was expressing his love for her. And so she rushed up to Narcissus, threw her arms around him, and attempted to kiss him. Narcissus was repulsed by her actions. He pushed her away. "Go away, away," she repeated. And off she went. And for the rest of her days, she traveled about until there was no Echo anymore, only her voice echoing the words of others. And you've probably heard her in a forest, in a canyon. And now Narcissus, later on, some months later, he came back to that same forest, to that same quarry pool. And as he was walking along with his selfie stick, taking more pictures of himself, he came up to the edge, the cliff above that pool. And he was adjusting himself on the selfie stick so he could get the perfect shot of his beautiful face and the pool below, when he stepped just a little bit too far back. And he slipped and he fell to his death on the rocks below. And where his blood seeped out onto the ground, there sprouted a flower. This one was white with a golden center, and it was called a narcissus. Now there are many colored narcissus, or narcissi, narcissus of all shades, whether they are wild or cultivated. And a person who is entranced with his own self-love is thought of as being narcissistic. And that's a story of Echo and Narcissus. And this particular story, my twist, the story is influenced by two real events. Three summers ago or so, we were in Rome and we were at the Colosseum. Hordes of people, I think that's pretty much every time and any time, except for probably now. But there were people everywhere, and that wasn't so bad. But it was the selfie sticks waving around in the air and bocking you on the head. It was quite a revelation. In some places, I understand that they've actually banned selfie sticks, which is probably a good thing. As far as stepping off a cliff, that is influenced by several real events right here in San Diego, Sunset Cliffs, where people fell off the cliff while they were trying to take digital photos of themselves. Thank you very much, and we'll send it back and get up our next storyteller. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jim. I love, or maybe not so much love, the connection to the contemporary things that are happening. So I want to introduce our final storyteller this evening. Closing out is Anne Leanne, a professional storyteller and actor for more than 20 years in San Diego. Anne Leanne loves teaching and performing for all ages, from preschool to adult. She has presented nationally from the Healing Story Alliance and is the winner of the 2020 NSN First Ever Virtual Story Slam. She loves to weave music and singing in with nearly all the traditional and personal tales that she tells, and has a unique vision on Greek and the world mythology and other world mythology. And Leanne has taught in residencies and workshops through arts, from learning. Oh my goodness, I'm going to start that over because my sentence was cut weird. She has taught residencies and workshops through arts of learning directly with many local school districts, as well as the Storytellers of San Diego Storytelling Institute. And Leanne is a state liaison for the National Storytelling Network, founding secretary of the Storytellers of San Diego, and a proud member of San Diego Arts League. I am so sorry for butchering your introduction, Leanne, but you are going to be wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, thank you so much, Misha. That was great. I'm going to just hope that I'm on the view here. It's not showing up on my screen, but I'll just proceed as though I am. There are two pieces in Cammie Staros' show at Lux that reference the myth that my story is based on. My story is called Leda by the River. And she has entitled those two pieces Leda and Leda and the Swan. If you haven't downloaded the app, like Jim said, and experienced the show, you really have to. Go to Lux, download it. I was able to, using this device, put her pieces in my home and walk around them in 3D. It was just amazing. So please do that. Both of the pieces are beautifully built amphora, and on top are placed bowls that act as heads, and there's jowls and things through them. There's amazing feminine eyes, and I just fell in love with those pieces. I had something else planned and decided this is the best I have to tell this story. Throughout the ages, the depictions in statuary and painting of Leda and the swan are, they tend to show the swan Zeus pressed against her or holding her down with his beak or even copulating with her. Or there's another one where it's much, much later and there's a more normal swan referenced in the background, and she's usually either with eggs or with her four famous children. But Cammie's pieces don't really reference the Zeus character at all. There's a hint of feather, but mostly what you see is the femininity, the mystery of Leda, that made me think maybe there was something more going on that's interesting with Leda than with Zeus. She went down to the river, and into the river she dived. She went down to the river at night. Is a dream a lie if it don't come true? Or is it something worse? Leda loved swans. As a girl, she would seek them out. The royal gardeners knew if they wanted to keep their favorite little princess happy, they would build a pond or a lake into the garden, and she would come down and feed them and watch them for hours, gliding gracefully across the water. Now, as a woman, a new wife, and thus newly made queen of Sparta, she had been delighted to find a flock that gathered every evening by a nearby riverside, where she could go and bathe and swim and see her precious swans. Pandarius, her husband and her king, had made it clear he was proud of his wise and exquisitely beautiful wife, but he would not be pleased with her until she gave him an heir. And until then, her position would not be secure. Well, she did her duty in that regard, of course, but there was less passion and none of the thrill that Leda had been led to believe there would be in such actions. So, she had responsibilities and pressures that made her restless. Today she was particularly restless. It had seemed like someone or something was watching her all the time. She couldn't see them, but they wanted something from her. She could barely wait until Apollo's sun had started descending toward the horizon before she rushed down to the riverside to see her swans and take a swim. She went down to the river, down to the river she'd ride. And as she got there, there he was. She had just removed her clothing to swim when she saw the largest swan she had ever seen. He was gliding almost a ballet back and forth across the water, his dark webbed feet and ebony beak stunning against the perfect snowy whiteness of his feathers, his sinewy neck, his movements. She was mesmerized. His eyes with a strange intelligence. Zeus! But before she could recognize a longing she would never name, an eagle cried in the sky and began to hurtle down towards that large swan, talons extended. The swan started and with his huge, powerful wings flew towards Leda. Acting on instinct alone, she reached out and brought him to her breast protectively. The poet says the dark webs caressed her thighs. The poet says her vague fingers could never have pushed away his feathered glory. And then the poet asks, did she put on his knowledge with his power in that moment? Perhaps her brain and body were shaken by the god's power and knowledge. She went home and found Thandarius and brought him to her bed. And a new passion and thrill filled the royal bed that night and after that. And Thandarius was pleased, especially when she began to grow round with her pregnancy and huge, so enormous, in fact, that twins were expected. The midwife was called, oh, my lady, so large, and yet every night you still swim in the river. It'll be ducks you'll be birthing, my lady. The dark shadow crossed the Queen of Sparta's face. No, not ducks. When her hour came, the midwife gathered all her ladies together. And in the midst of Leda's travails, the midwife called out, push. And the roundness was crowning when there was a gasp from the midwife, and she cleared the room of all the women, except for the Queen of Sparta's oldest nurse, brought to her from childhood. And as Leda gave birth to two huge eggs, the nurse cried out, what dark magic is this? The midwife said, hush, it is all as the gods will. And Leda, strong and powerful from her child bed, reached down and lifted each of her children in turn to name them. From the first egg, two tiny babies. First, the golden-haired Castor, feisty and smiling. And in the egg with him, the beautiful and powerful Clytemnestra. Oh, two children, so beautiful, so perfect as any who had ever been in the land of Sparta. Until, that is, the second egg hatched in a bright divine light. And Leda reached down for the dark-haired boy, Pollux, who with his first breath reached into his mother's lap and lifted his brother. And so Castor and Pollux were entwined for all of Castor's mortal life. And perhaps beyond. And then her second daughter. Leda picked up the tiny, perfect baby as the light dissipated. Already perfect ringlets framed a face too strong a feature for an infant and yet stunning nonetheless. Oh, she smelled of honeysuckle and new-mown hay. No mewling or puking or making cross wrinkly faces for this beautiful child. The shadow of the god's power and knowledge came one last time to Lita. She saw the wall fall, the tower and the roof burn, and Agamemnon dead. Then it was gone, and she tickled Helen's perfect chin. Is this the face that will launch a thousand ships? Is a dream a lie if it don't come true? Or is it something worse? Is a dream a lie if it don't come true? Or could it be a curse that brought her down to the river that night? Lita, by the river. I want to say thank you to the poet William Butler Yeats, for I used his words throughout, and to Mr. Bruce Springsteen, and to the Chinese Women's Association and Lux Art Institute, who have supported us, and the rest of the Storytellers of San Diego as well, but most importantly, to Cammie Staros, whose beautiful artworks have inspired in me all new views of many, many different myths. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Leanne. I would like to invite all of the storytellers to come join us again on a view, and we can answer some questions. Thank you all three so much for, it's just such a nice way to spend a Friday evening. You know, I'm sitting here just enthralled and enjoying, and I really love it. So thank you all so much. So I want to start off kind of hearing a more general question. Where can we see you all coming up in the future? What kind of projects are you doing coming up?
That's such a good question, because we have monthly events at Eclipse. Normally, in the before times, we'd have been at Eclipse Chocolate and at the Twisted Horn Meat Hall once a month. And so we are continuing that in virtual space. Mindy, are you hosting the next one? No, I can't remember who's hosting the next one at Eclipse, but I know that I'll be telling a story there. My award-winning slam story, in fact.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's the first Thursday of the month with Eclipse, and the third Thursday with Twisted Horn Meat Hall.
So the next Thursday is your slam story. Wonderful. Mindy, just so you know, you are muted. I don't know if you meant to have yourself muted.
Yeah, thank you. It flipped back.
The other thing about our monthlies is that the one at Eclipse is they're pre-recorded. So that's on YouTube. And the links can be found on the Storytellers of San Diego webpage, which is storytellersofsandiego.org. So that's where you'll find the link to those, and there's the archived ones as well for the different programs that we've done for Eclipse. The ones from Twisted Horn on the third Thursday are done as Zoom. So those are live Zoom, but we also archive those, and they are also available on YouTube as well. So all of the virtual work that we've done since April, I guess we would say, is on our YouTube channel. So that's storytellersofsandiego.org as well. And you can find all of our YouTube programs. What we do is we set them up as playlists. So the different programs. So the upcoming one for this Thursday is being hosted by Marilyn McPhee, and the that's right, yeah. And that is the theme, as as Leon said, as masks, because that was the theme for the story slam that Leon did triumph greatly. So we're so proud of her, and we're looking forward to an excellent series of stories there. I'm going to do a couple stories. Leon's doing one. Marilyn's already sent hers to me. So, and Patty Christensen, I know, and I don't know who else, but we have.
I am.
Oh, you too, Mindy. All right, super.
Resident mask maker, Mindy Donner.
There we go.
It's the very easy.
We've got a great program. Every one of them, I think, is super. And we give the opportunity for people to make a little donations as well. Try to help out people a little bit here and there. So super. Thanks for asking.
Yeah, I love that. The very easy, non-complicated conversation of masks, definitely. I think that's such a complicated, but there's so many layers to it. And I love that, you know, people there. Well, y'all know complexity to the mask is really interesting. Yes, Leah.
Oh, I was just reading in the comments that Pat Warner asked about this being the last collaboration with Lux for while. He wondered I don't know, Pat or they.
Thank you so much for asking, Pat. So this is the last Art and Stories event that we have for now, but definitely not the last time we're collaborating with the Storytellers of San Diego. You know, we love you guys, and you know, we hope that we can collaborate again in the future in all different capacities. We actually, today, Marilyn McPhee did a wonderful program with for the end of our summer art camp. You know, the last for Art and Stories for now, but definitely not the last I'm collaborating. I also had another question, and you told us a little bit about why you were telling the stories that you were telling, but I'm really interested in hearing why you picked these particular stories as they relate to you. Was there something that you recognized in these stories that you wanted to share, or something that you find humorous about, you know, how it relates to contemporary world, or something you've seen a lot? I'm really curious how you're personally connecting to these stories.
I'll start. I don't consider myself to be particularly narcissistic, but totally opposite.
Not at
but,
all.
I find the story, as I find most Greek mythology, to be extremely contemporary in its essence of what the stories, how they speak to people and to the human condition. I mean, obviously, it's been the source of some of the greatest literature, not only the myths themselves, but what has been derived from them throughout history. So I would say that just the overall appeal of the human condition as it's depicted in the stories themselves. Okay, somebody else?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and go next. Like I had said, until I saw Cammie's Leda and Leda and the Swan, two pieces, I was like, yeah, I guess I'd better have a look at this. I had planned on something else, but as I approached the story again, the themes of, sometimes that's depicted as a rape with Zeus and sometimes as seduction. And I thought that was an interesting thing too, to kind of explore the sexuality of this, which is something I don't usually do a lot of with my storytelling, but Greek and Roman mythology is so ripe with it that this was a really great time to have a look at that. And also just those things about being a mother as the security for your place. I thought that was really interesting too. I have two grown boys now, and it is really interesting being the mother of adults, because I think that when you're entering parenthood, right, you're thinking about how I'm going to take care of a baby, how I'm going to take care of a little one, how maybe I won't die when they're teenagers, but to be a mother of adults is so rewarding and fascinating. And I can relate to those feelings of having famous children that Lita did, because I feel like my kids definitely outshine me. So.
Always. Sweet.
I have such a long love affair with myths. And when I saw Cammie's work, it came to me that I looked at her website as well. It came to me that Perseus and Medusa, which had been concocted about 16 years ago with my dear friend and a colleague, Ian Gunn, that some of the images in it, like I love the appropriation, or in some cases the misappropriation of objects, which have certainly lost their utilitarian beings and become something else. And for me, that world of mix and match has to do with the substance, the materials, the movement, what suggests what. And when I saw Cammie's, maybe it was on her website, there was a whale. I had purchased this whale, which I just put a little rod on, at IKEA during a shopping trip for another play. And I haven't used it. It's probably been at least 10 years, but I knew this was whale. And when I saw that she had a whale, and then I could make reference to caught reclining while being nude, because that's what Medusa is all about. And it just felt like a nice fit. So where I find myself in that story is not as personally as I find myself in Demeter and Persephone, in which story I lived for 10 years and produced it as a play, but it's just the humor seemed to go with the wry humor of her work. Just that.
I love that. Yeah, Cammie's work is definitely very humorous. And
very humorous.
Curious. Exactly. I love it. And I think all of you embodied her ideas in very wonderful and unique and funny, but also serious and beautiful ways. And I really, really enjoyed it. And I want to thank all three of you and Marilyn McPhee and the Storytellers of San Diego for having these wonderful events and letting me be part of it, because I really enjoy it. So thank you so much, everybody. And I'm going to send everybody home. We're already home. Send everybody home.
And I'm going to just wave and say hi from New York, because I am in New York State in quarantine. So this was a real pleasure to be able to be in California and New York at the same time.
I know. Distance is no longer a limitation to the possibilities of collaboration. So it's wonderful. Yeah.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate our involvement between the Storytellers of San Diego and Lux Art Institute. It's been a wonderful thing, and we just hope that we're able to continue. So,
yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll make other opportunities in the future for sure.
Excellent. Right.
Thank you, everybody, so much. Have a wonderful weekend, and we'll see y'all soon.
Good night.